The WHO recently came out with a guideline on artificial sweeteners, and basically they discourage their use. And based on the scientific evidence that we have, I suspect their overall logic is wrong. Drama. So we'll go over the scientific evidence in a nutshell. I'll explain what I mean, of course. Real quick, I have no conflicts of interest in this area, no checks from Big Sugar or Big Sweetener or Big anything. We're just going over the available scientific evidence and trying to figure out what's most likely to be true. So there's basically two ways that you can study the effect of a food or a product on human health. You can take a group of people and split them randomly and give half that food you're interested in or product and see what happens. That's called the randomized trial. The other way is to ask a population of people how much of that food or product each person normally eats in their daily life, and then follow them for years and see what happens to their health. And you can look for a connection between the intake of that product or food and their health outcomes. So that's called an observational study because you're not intervening, you're not changing anything, you're just observing. Long story short, when we look at the randomized trials that we have, in general, they point to safety of artificial sweeteners and even some benefit. People who are randomized to the group adding artificial sweeteners or increasing their intake of artificial sweeteners tend to show a reduction in body weight. Some trials even compare artificial sweeteners to water. And overall, it's pretty common to see no statistically significant difference between them, suggesting that artificial sweeteners are not just better than regular added sugar, but even compared to water, we don't see a clear superiority, at least for these parameters that are reported, like weight loss. Now, randomized trials are great. The problem is they're usually short, normally a few months, a year, 2 years if we're really lucky. And that's for many reasons. They are costly to run. They're logistically complicated. Also, adherence. In a randomized trial, you have to convince people to change their diet or their habit. And there's only so long you can keep people on a change like that before you lose your participants to adherence. Now, the observational studies can be much longer. They can last decades. And this is where it gets interesting, because in observational studies, often people consuming more artificial sweeteners tend to have higher risk of disease, higher risk of obesity than people consuming less artificial sweeteners. So in this graph, the line in the middle is the reference, the null, if you will. So anything above the line is an increase in risk. Also common to see higher risk of coronary heart disease and even higher risk of total death. So we have this conundrum. We have this contradiction between the short-term randomized data on one hand and the long-term observational data on the other. And the WHO essentially erred on the side of caution and said the short-term benefit seen in the trials is trumped by these concerns coming from the long-term observational studies. Now, this is debatable. Some people argue that the randomized trials should get more weight because they're randomized, which everything else held equal is methodologically more robust, gets rid of more confounders. Other people agree with the WHO and they think, yeah, the observational studies should be given preference because they're longer. But here's the thing. There's a chance that these results from these observational studies are an artifact anyway. People who consume more artificial sweeteners often do that to try to lose weight and to get healthier. So we might be seeing a higher risk in that population because they're heavier and sicker to begin with, not because artificial sweeteners cause disease. This phenomenon is called reverse causation, when the direction of cause and effect is different from what it might appear at first glance. Now, the authors of the WHO guideline are completely aware that this is a possibility. These people are not dumb. These are professional nutrition scientists who do this for a living. And in fact, they mention this possibility in their report, but they still lean towards the observational studies, mainly because the randomized trials tend to be much shorter. But what they pay less attention to is that there are other ways to look at observational data and more robust ways than this default analysis. For example, instead of just looking at people consuming more artificial sweeteners versus people consuming less, we can look at specific alternatives. And the one that makes the most sense is regular added sugar. So for example, we might compare diet soda to regular soda. And we can do this for specific dosages. So let's say the health effect of one serving a day or one can a day of regular soda compared to the health effect of one can a day of diet soda. And at the same time, you can try to adjust for all the other variables, things like BMI, presence of diabetes, other dietary factors even. And so you can try to isolate the effect of these products on health. So this is called the substitution analysis, precisely because it's looking at head-to-head two alternatives. And in general, it's more robust than just the default observational approach. And it helps minimize some of this reverse causation risk. And when we look at this type of analysis, the results change dramatically. We see lower risk of obesity comparing artificially sweetened products to regular sugar sweetened products. So for example, people drinking diet soda instead of regular soda, lower risk of heart disease, lower risk of total death. So none of these techniques are perfect. The randomized trials also aren't perfect. There's always a degree of uncertainty, but in general, a substitution analysis is a bit more compelling than a standard observational study. And these results align with the randomized trial results, suggesting benefits short-term and long-term of replacing sugar-sweetened beverages and products with artificially sweetened products. So this is why I lean towards artificial sweeteners are probably beneficial, at least compared to regular added sugars. If the evidence in the future continues to support this, continues to mount in that direction, probably what's going to happen is the WHO is going to change its guidelines. If, on the other hand, evidence starts pointing to more concerns of artificial sweeteners and suggesting that, no, they're just as bad as added sugar, then I'm going to change my views. That's how science works. Views follow evidence. Now, in a perfect world, we would just run a massive randomized trial with a million people over 20 years, right? And just nail this. In reality, that's almost impossible. We'll probably never have that. So we have to make educated decisions with the information we have. Now, very interestingly, as we were preparing this video, a new trial came out. And this is one of the larger ones that we have. A year of follow-up, almost 500 participants, and they were all overweight before the trial. They were all placed on a weight loss program, and then they were randomly split. Half of them were told to replace some of the regular soda that they drink with water, and the other half with artificially sweetened drinks, like diet soda. And both groups lost weight, and if anything, the group on the artificially sweetened replacement lost a bit more weight, 7.5 versus 6 kilos lost over the course of the year. And this is possibly because the sweetness of the artificial sweetener satisfied them a bit more, so they ate a little bit less on the side than the guys who just replaced with water. And so basically the results of this new trial align with the evidence we had before. Now, in their defense, the WHO committee makes some really good points in their report. For example, they point out that artificial sweeteners, non-sugar sweeteners, aren't the only way to reduce added sugars in the diet. Fruit is also an option. Or unsweetened food and drinks. So they're referring to things like water and tea, for example. Yeah, those are perfectly valid options. Another good point they make, that just replacing free sugars with artificial sweeteners, for example, swapping soda with diet soda, by itself is not going to massively overhaul the overall quality of the diet, because we're still eating a highly processed product. That's a good point. I agree that overall dietary quality is of paramount importance. But the question is, in terms of public health and implementation, how do we get people there, right? How do we get a population that eats a very unhealthy diet to move in that direction? Because it's easy for me to talk. I don't consume diet soda. I don't consume regular soda either. So I don't feel any need for these products, but I'm not the target audience. The question is, somebody who consumes a lot of regular soda, 2, 3, 4 cans a day, and who finds it difficult, who finds it impractical to simply transition to water or tea, who's not going to stick with that. If diet soda helps them cut back, is that a positive move or not health-wise? And most of the evidence we have suggests that it is. So we can explain that science. We can explain the different factors without necessarily encouraging a diet of junk food. So hopefully that gives you some information to make your own educated decisions. Here's a lot more on artificial sweeteners, and here are some general tips to ditch the refined sugars. Check those out. I'll meet you over there.